we get into it, I wanted to let you know that there are a lot of flashing lights in this episode. I have included a chevron as well as this tone to indicate the start and end of a flashing light segment. I have tried to keep these to a minimum, but I did not start having light sensitivity until near the end of this project. Also, this video is censored due to YouTube's age restriction being a death sentence. If you want to watch the uncensored version, please check out my Patreon. Now that we've got that out of the way, enjoy this deep dive into Event Horizon.
2015. First permanent colony established on Mars. 2032. Commercial mining began on Mars. 2040. Deep space research vessel Event Horizon launched to explore boundaries of solar system. During routine maintenance, its reactor went critical, atomizing the ship. Nothing is recoverable. It is the worst space disaster on record. Now, the USAC intercepted a radio transmission from a decaying orbit around Neptune. The source has been identified as the Event Horizon.
Children, welcome to the Green Lodge. You ever have one of those movies that's always haunted you? Something that helps shape who you are as a person? When I was a child, I had a neighbor and my half-sister rent some horror films from our local video store, and I snuck behind the couch to watch the films without their knowledge. And, well, arachnophobia gave me a healthy fear of spiders. And the other film I still haven't quite been able to identify, but the closest I've been able to get so far is Spookies. Event Horizon is one of those foundational films for me. The first time I tripped over it was when my parents were watching it at home. I would have been around 12 years old by the time it was released on DVD, but if there's anything that's going to attract my family to see a film, it's a movie in
space!
What I do remember is seeing, quite accidentally, the scene of Weir inside the Gravity Drive's corridors attempting to fix the burnt-out fuse, only to have it flicker on and off and his eyeless wife suddenly appear. I quickly retreated, but the image was burned into my brain and would stay there until I finally watched the full film, and by that time, I was hooked. That being said, this is one of those films that, while it didn't do well in theaters, has only grown in almost everybody's estimation in the decades since.
I have nothing but bad things to say about Event Horizon.
Really?
It's a terrible premise.
So you hate it to its core.
It has inspired so many science fiction creations, as well as one of the most inventive and terrifying horror video games, Dead Space. I wanted to make sure I thanked Paul Kane up front. Without his book, the Hellraiser films and their legacy, I can honestly say I would not have recognized one of the biggest links between the first two Hellraiser movies and Event Horizon, one that I haven't seen anyone else put together. Definitely check it out. But before we get to that, I wanted to thank my patrons,
Chris Markinson, Stormy OK, Bryce Cleek, Catherine C., and Larry Quarterwitz.
Every dollar is put right back into the channel, and I always have new ideas that I'd like to pursue. Right now, I have that two-hour Hellraiser series deep dive that I'm aching to do, but we need to hit 50 patrons first so I can spend the time required to make it as good as I know it will be. So, please spread the word and let's get to that goal. How does Event Horizon size up as it's approaching 25 years since its release? I'm sure you already know this, but...
And I have such wonderful, wonderful things to show you.
Oh, my name is Justin D. Hurd. I'm all sewn up. Are you ready to go? Funny story. My initial pitch for this video was Hellraiser.
In space!
But you know, actually good. It was an easy way to be both dismissive of Hellraiser 4 Bloodline, as well as raising up Event Horizon's pedigree, despite it being one of the most loved horror films of the 90s. But I actually found a legacy that tied Event Horizon to the first three Hellraiser films, with almost a dozen crew that crossed over from one series to the other. There's definitely a concrete reason why it's so easy to put Event Horizon into the Hellraiser canon, though I'm not sure the director even realized it. More on that later. Set in the year 2047, Event Horizon focuses on a small search and rescue team sent to investigate the lost ship. 7 years before, the ship had been trying an experimental drive to achieve faster-than-light travel, only for it to disappear.
Ave atque vale. Hail and farewell.
Along for the ride is Dr. Weir, the designer of the original Event Horizon and its theoretical gravity drive. While there isn't much of this in the actual film, the deleted scenes show when the ship disappeared, he lost all credibility and was set adrift in the 7 years since. He hitches a ride with the crew of the Lewis and Clark, though he doesn't explain his reason for being there until they've already jumped through hyperspace and been in stasis for nearly 2 months. The crew members are quickly introduced but have enough of a repertoire that you do grow to like them despite Cooper's cringy one-liners.
Would you like something hot and black inside you?
Ooh.
Weir describes how the gravity drive works in the same way Interstellar would later use nearly two decades later.
Illustrations. I'm trying to show you how it works. So they say you want to go from here to there. But it's too far, right?
Mm-hmm.
So a wormhole bends space like this, so you can take a shortcut through a higher dimension.
Back to the Event Horizon itself. The crew enters the ship, blissfully unaware of the gore just out of their view. Add to that, they are in a decaying orbit in the upper atmosphere of Neptune with a storm surrounding the ship, which does a lot to add to the haunted house tone of the piece. At first, the ship seems completely abandoned, sans any signs of the original crew until they trip over a severed hand and a mauled corpse, before Mr. Justin is sucked into the gravity drive and left catatonic. The resulting shockwave severely damages the Lewis and Clark, leaving the entire crew to abandon ship and board the Event Horizon. There, they finally get the barest hint of what had happened to that original crew. What they're left with is an operational ghost ship with a scrambled flight recording and the growing awareness that something went very fucking wrong. The crew is forced to hunker down while being plagued with horror-filled visions that cut the crew to their very core. And I guess I should state that this is one of the most prominent downsides to the film, the cookie-cutter characters. While we do get attached to them as the story goes on, it is as pared down as it could feasibly be for a horror feature film. Now, don't get me wrong, this is no Friday the 13th, where the characters are there just to be slaughtered.
Ted! Hey, Ted! Where the hell's Corkscrew?
It does help that the Event Horizon itself is playing off their personal fears, ones that they haven't even shared with their coworkers and friends. This is only really sullied by lines such as,
"The dark inside me."
I do love the way the ship contours itself to each crew member, even if a lot of the details got lost in the quick edits they had to do to get this film out by its pre-announced date. Stuff like Jason Isaacs' DJ having an old surgery scar and being deathly afraid of it opening up again, only to have himself vivisected and hung from the very same wound he'd gotten all those years ago. I do find Jason Isaacs' reaction to people believing it was him hung up there hilarious, because how would he have had his guts splayed out?
But the thing that was most disturbing about doing the film was the body they made. They made a complete body cast of me that they hung up and gutted and ripped all my entrails out. And it was an absolutely perfect facsimile of me. And a lot of people think that that was me hung up on hooks. I don't know how they think I did my rib cage being open.
But then you have Anderson and producer Jeremy Bolt saying shit like this.
The reason why we made the tables mirrored was actually to accommodate this shot where you see his intestines laid on the table and then a reflection of his body hanging. And actually for that reflection shot of Jason Isaacs, it was Jason who we hung up there because I was worried that the body sculpt that we'd built wouldn't hold for the close-up.
We built this huge prosthetic of him. And he's basically dead, but he lifts his head up and he speaks. And Jason just loved all this gory stuff.
As for the actual evil that has infected the Event Horizon, It was originally devised to be an alien intelligence, but was changed in an effort to distance itself from the well-worn trope of an alien stowaway. The writer, Philip Eisner, stated that the original idea was to have a Lovecraftian Elder God situation, with inky black worlds under a dead star.
In Philip's original script, the reason for the manifestations and the haunting, as it were, is that there were aliens. They were kind of like these tentacular aliens, and the Event Horizon had been to their planet or dimension, and the aliens are kind of were inhabiting the spaceship. And I didn't want to go in that direction. I wanted something less specific than that. I liked the whole idea of hell. I like the whole idea of the ship itself being possessed rather than going, oh, it's an alien consciousness that's doing this.
But that was changed to be more relevant to the vast majority of Christians. The producers really tried to get it said concretely that the ship had traveled to the actual hell. At any point he could, Eisner pulled away from that idea, but they managed to work in the line.
Hell is only a word. The reality is much, much worse.
Which he felt helped pull them away from a strict definition. One of the nice details is that the ship has to trick people into killing themselves, or each other, rather than it being able to reach out and actively do so. While it goes out of its way to kill the crew of the Lewis and Clark, it seems to recognize that Weir is its creator, or at least the most unstable of everyone else, and instead drives him to the brink of madness, transforming him into its avatar. Although he designed it, he becomes the hands for its grim machinations. Even when he's jettisoned out into space with no ability to get back, as opposed to what we see with Cooper, he is able to respawn to continue attacking the crew. Eventually, he faces off against Captain Miller as his own personal demon in the gravity drive chamber, albeit Weir shows up completely nude, covered in fresh wounds amidst all the hellfire. Throughout his time on the ship, Captain Miller has received flashes of his crew being tortured and is shown even more in the final confrontation with Weir. We do see what happened to the previous crew through quick shots of the infamous blood orgy that's been lost to the inferior preservation practices of the time.
We've been unable to locate, unfortunately, all of that footage. It's one of the interesting things about Event is it was really done before the DVD revolution. So there was no real attempt to keep all of this material because there was no real avenue for it to be released. When it came to the point where we started looking for doing a new version of the movie, we literally had to go all over the world to look for offcuts from the film, negative from the film. A lot of the film was being stored in a salt mine in Transylvania, of all places.
These are some of the most impressive and over-the-top visuals in the film, and we get only the briefest of impressions of the carnage. But that's what also makes them so alluring. This has one of my favorite deadpan moments of the film, when the crew has finally cleaned up the scrambled footage, only for Lawrence Fishburne's Miller to shut it off.
We're leaving.
Needless to say, the chaos space they're about to enter is a fate worse than death, and it makes all the sense in the world that Miller would sacrifice himself in order to save what remains of his crew. As a result, we see the heart of the Event Horizon sucked into a black hole that it uses to travel. While the film leaves it open whether it survived that journey, we're left with the three remaining crew members going into stasis.
Approaching the wreckage of the Event Horizon, prepare to board.
When they've woken up, Lieutenant Stark is left a gibbering mess on the floor, leaving us to believe she's been driven insane by her experiences aboard the Event Horizon. This movie isn't perfect, but it's got a strong backbone to it, and I love a lot of the details brought to this production. Director Paul W.S. Anderson made sure to build the sets as practical as he could, using CG sparingly, instead relying on miniatures and old-fashioned camera tricks to make the set seem even bigger. He made sure to work the Gothic architecture into the design of the ship itself, as well as creating circular rooms to accommodate his sweeping shots. He also made it a priority to make the sets multi-level so they felt real, despite the hardships that created in filming the scenes. And he did all this under an incredibly tight deadline. Originally, Anderson's follow-up to Mortal Kombat was going to be Soldier with Kurt Russell. However, Kurt decided that he wanted to take a year to get into shape for that production, leaving an opening in Anderson's schedule. He had been in talks early on to do Event Horizon, but with a year now free, he jumped at the opportunity.
So I ended up making Event Horizon basically while Kurt Russell was getting into fabulous shape for Soldier.
Add to that, Paramount wanted an August 1997 release because Titanic wasn't going to hit its date, and they needed something to fill the gap. Anderson had to turn this entire thing around, despite production woes stemming from sizing an entirely different opening and retooling it throughout the script, to nearly burning down the stage when the flamethrower they were using fell over and tried to take the set with it.
The big fireball, we did that as a practical fireball on stage. We had this huge flamethrower that shot a massive practical fireball down the stage, and the flamethrower started, and the force of the flame was so great, it fell off its pedestal and it started shooting the flame at the ceiling. And the set was all wood, so the set started to burn. And then the flamethrower rolled over and started shooting through the floor of the set. And underneath the floor was where all the gas tanks were that were feeding the flamethrower. So it was actually shooting flame at the gas tanks, at which point we just had to abandon the stage. I mean, we literally thought the whole thing was going to blow up.
He also gave up his right to 10 weeks of editing and instead cut his time down to 6 weeks, which was also pared down due to him shooting with the second unit for another 2 weeks to finish the film. As a result, he was only able to do 3 edits, the last of which is still what is on the 2021 Shout Factory release. Roughly 40 minutes of footage was lost thanks to behind-the-scenes special features and cut footage not being prioritized or really even saved. In fact, the making of documentary and commentary wasn't produced until the mid-2000s. Frankly, I'm amazed this thing turned out as good as it did, and its lasting legacy is a testament to how visceral the final product is. So as I've mentioned, there's a good reason why this movie is so flippantly called Hellraiser in space! It's funny to me that I've watched so many retrospectives and opinion pieces on this, and no one seems to have found the simple connection between Event Horizon and Hellraiser. Second Unit Director Robin Vidgeon. So you might be asking what the job of the Second Unit Director is and why I'm so focused on it. Well, they are responsible for pickup and establishing shots, stunts, inserts, and cutaways. While it's not as glamorous a position as the main cinematographer, it is a key part of the whole, creating cohesion between the finer acting bits, the stunts, and overall feel of the piece. Now, if you look at Rob's IMDb, you'll find over 100 plus credits from camera and electrical departments to cinematographer, and a specific credit we want to focus on here. He was called in to take over the position of second unit director after they'd had a lot of issues with the original production. Now, Rob had originally thought he was being hired to be the director of photography, only to realize quite quickly that he was to be the second unit director. He was given free rein to replace anyone he wanted, and so he opted to start fresh with everyone except for the second unit's current director of photography, who was matching the cinematography of Adrian Biddle.
And so when I went in, it didn't take me long to understand why the second unit were not functioning properly. They didn't have a production manager. They were waiting 10, 12 hours for actors to come to their set on another stage. And at 8 o'clock at night, the actors had been there since 7 in the morning and wanted to go home. And so they did. So some days, the second unit were getting nothing.
That being said, the reason that Rob Vidgeon is such an important figure in this is twofold. Rob Vidgeon was the cinematographer for the original Hellraiser, as well as Hellbound Hellraiser 2. By the time he had been hired for Hellraiser, Vidgeon already had 20 years worth of experience, lending a critical eye to the constraints of the house they were filming in, as well as masterful lighting that is directly responsible for a lot of the beauty amidst the horror. He's not the only holdover from those films, though. In fact, there are 10 other people that were involved in these productions in varying positions of importance. That being said, there's also roughly 15 people that came from Aliens as well. They clearly knew who they were hiring, trying to recreate a feeling other films had established. As it's always said, it's amazing any film gets made because it's hundreds of people coming together for a collaborative vision. It's one of those things that completely dismantles auteur theory, which both Lindsay Ellis and Shannon Strucci have covered in vastly different ways. Links in the description. Now, it should be noted that Paul W.S. Anderson considers himself to be the only director on the film, despite the obvious practicalities of the filmmaking business. He would take over the second unit during the weekends for the blood orgy sequence that ultimately has been lost to time and neglect.
The other scene that was heavily trimmed was what happened to the original crew of the Event Horizon. There was a whole big, violent, bloody orgy scene where essentially the crew were fucking each other to death, and it was pretty bloody and unpleasant.
He even brought on a separate director to help shoot the blood orgy.
I was actually helped by another director who came in to direct second unit a couple of times, called Vadim Jean. He's done a lot of romantic comedies like Leon the Pig Farmer.
And now for something completely different.
Jewish?
Look, I've said I'm sorry.
What are you getting so worked up about? So we're all products of artificial insemination. So what?
Do we have to talk about this?
Here, here. Are you joking?
mix them up? You mix them up?
Wakey, wakey! Time to get up!
Oh, God.
But he clearly has a dark side to him, because when I brought him in, I'd started shooting these sequences and then I kind of ran out of time. I had to go back to the main unit. So he came in and he shot a lot of the violent, orgiastic scenes.
Yet, he still considers himself the only director. One thing I thought exceedingly interesting in light of this information is that something similar happened during the shooting of Mortal Kombat. The first fight scene I shot with Robin Shu, here's a man who has done Hong Kong movies. I haven't done any of them. We started doing the master shot, and it's this big, long fight, and we do it all in one take as a wide master, but there are a couple mistakes, so I do it again. Then there are a couple more, so I do it again. And of course, these guys are getting exhausted, because they are going for it. Robin comes up to me and says, Paul, you do know what coverage is, don't you? And I said, oh yeah, sorry about that. In fight scenes, you use the wide shot for maybe like 2 seconds, and that's it. You're always in for the tight coverage for the impacts. It was a movie I learned a lot on, and I was very fortunate to be working with people who were supportive and didn't bite my head off when I made them repeatedly do fights in wide shots.
They do everything in masters. Everything. They do a wide master, they do a medium master, they do a close master, and they say, excuse me, Paul, you know, like, maybe we can cut here and then do an insert there, so we kind of save energy and save time. Say, no, but it's spectacular to do, like, one whole take.
Now, I don't blame Anderson for being new to shooting action scenes and relying on a veteran to make sure his directing is functional and not actively hurting his performers. However, it is telling that it happened again with Vidgeon's involvement on his third picture, which directly followed Mortal Kombat. Since we don't know the timeline for Vidgeon's hiring and restructuring of the second unit, it's impossible to tell if this was actively undercutting his job or a symptom of the previous director not being up to the task. It's pretty obvious that Vidgeon didn't have anything to do with the more extreme portions of the film.
There was a sequence to do in the spaceship when the main unit wasn't on it and we weren't, and they shot for 2 days the material. I don't know how much they used in the film because I haven't seen it, but they had 2 days of interesting photography.
But without his influence, it's hard to imagine that Event Horizon would be what it was in the first place, much less have been completed on time and with such a strong visual flair in the continuity of its shots. Now, I wanted to hit on a few of the inspirations that informed Event Horizon's particular brand of horror, as well as the projects that took up its baton and did new and exciting things with what he had established. I think we can all agree that Event Horizon wouldn't exist without Ridley Scott's foundational masterpiece. One of the things they definitely took from Alien was the varied cast of characters. Everyone was allowed to build their backstory and personalize their uniforms, which you'll notice Jason Isaacs overkill with little baubles here and there.
The other thing I wanted to do was have gadgets, since I was in a science fiction film. So I asked Paul if I could have a utility waistcoat, and I got this coat with, you know, billions of strange-looking implements in them. Tried to use them in various scenes, but mostly they just... they look rather cool.
If you watch the movie, he's got so many props, knives and belts, things and because he really got into that. And then about halfway through the movie, when he's realizing it's one thing to get all these props, but then you have to deal with them all the way through the film. It's like, Paul, why did you allow me to have all these fucking props? So that became the bane of his life, is how to deal with all of this stuff.
There's a whole feel with the ship that permeates the original Alien, and you can see how that informed the production design of Event Horizon. Not only do the crew quarters look like they were lifted right out of Alien, but the grungy feeling of the Nostromo has also been translated into the oily, gothic look of the ships. Everything feels lived in and has its own internal logic for the lighting. The next biggest influence has obviously got to be Clive Barker's seminal work, Hellraiser.
I was bored. I'd gone to the limit. There was nothing else I wanted. A box.
Not just any box. It opens doors. Doors to the pleasures of heaven or hell.
do anything you want. Anything.
You gave me an experience beyond the limits. Hellraiser, there are no limits.
We were quite inspired by the cube in Hellraiser and the way that it realigned itself and reshapes itself.
Stated producer Jeremy Bolt on the director's commentary. Paul W.S. Anderson's response?
Yes.
And that's all they said. Despite their reluctance to recognize how much was cribbed from Hellraiser, which even had its own spacefaring adventure the year before with Bloodline, it's clear that it was a heavy inspiration. I'm sure this is all quite clear to people who are familiar with both, but for those that aren't, a quick refresher. The Hellraiser series focuses on the limit configuration as it passes through the lives of a variety of people. The puzzle box, which tempts people to complete it and reconfigures itself as they get closer to solving it, summons sadomasochists from beyond the grave in the form of Cenobites. These creatures are explorers in the furthest reaches of experience, and are known to completely distort the human figure in an effort to achieve maximum pleasure. Event Horizon retools one of the most popular quotes from Hellraiser into,
"And they have such wonderful, wonderful things to show you."
Weir's wife really does serve the idea of angels to some, demons to others, as she tempts him to give himself over to the Event Horizon. Once we've clearly seen what happened to the previous crew, it brings to mind the line,
"Pain and pleasure. Indivisible."
Even Dr. Weir's scarification calls to mind Pinhead's handiwork, a visceral rending of flesh that Gary J. Tunnicliffe would seemingly use as an inspiration for his redesign of Pinhead. This was also revisited with the Auteur in 2018's Hellraiser Judgment, also directed by Gary J. Tunnicliffe. Now, there are several creations that were highlighted in the behind-the-scenes and commentary that served as inspirations. Apparently, Event Horizon was originally pitched as The Shining. This is one of the few things that I think the Nightflyers series managed to pull off better. There are several allusions to it, most obviously the turning of one of the leads into a killer, as well as one of the tanks filling with blood and escaping in a wave.
Stop!
Another direct inspiration was Robert Wise's 1963 masterpiece, The Haunting. You can even hear the iconic door slamming in Event Horizon when Peters is hearing things in Medbay. The Haunting is one of the best haunted house films, but one that focuses on the mindset of its lead rather than the typical jump scares that even plague Event Horizon. Obviously, the entire cast state of mind is integral to how the plot plays out and how the ship toys with them overall. Finally, the other big inspirations for the look and feel of Event Horizon were the following artists. Joel Peter Witkin, for his macabre photography that often brings to mind classical paintings, and obviously helped to craft the blood orgy's use of amputees and porn stars. Likewise, Hieronymus Bosch was a huge inspiration for their conception of their hellish equivalent. They also mentioned Peter Bruegel, who I was more familiar with for his rendition of the Tower of Babel, but he was inspired by Hieronymus Bosch's renditions of hell as well, and took his own crack at it. At the end of the day, we've got insane details presented throughout, from the gothic cathedral appearance of the Event Horizon to the painterly deaths of both crews. They obviously wanted to bring to life the feelings that art stirred in them. I know the comments would be set aflame if I didn't at least mention Warhammer 40K, with the entire idea of the chaos dimension they have to go through to travel faster than the light being presented more than 10 years before this film. In 40K, when you cross through that portal, you are then opened up to every emotion and its corrupting effect as they manifested in that alternate dimension. It's an obvious influence on Event Horizon. Like, they're not even subtle about how much they crib from it, even if Eisner implies it may not have been conscious. Now, I'm no expert on Warhammer 40K, so I'd recommend Bricky's deep dive into each of the factions if you want to learn more. I think I'd be remiss if I didn't at least mention that both Paul W.S. Anderson and the producer Jeremy Bolt comment that Eisner claims he had not seen either Disney's Black Hole or Tarkovsky's Solaris before production, but they don't believe it.
The reason for this coolant, this is something I added to the movie purely for the end result, which was when they switched the gravity back on, the idea that it was raining in a spaceship. That was an image I really, really liked.
Well, wasn't that inspired by Solaris? A little bit.
What is it?
At the end of Solaris, when it starts raining indoors?
Solaris? I've never heard of it. No, what are you talking about?
No, it's entirely original.
Philip Eisner actually denied that he'd never seen Solaris or Disney's The Black Hole. and I find that very hard to believe.
While the films have similar ideas, honestly, it's not enough for me to definitively say that he couldn't have come up with them on his own.
I'll give you an example of how thin this movie is. It's obviously inspired by Solaris, which is a great Russian film by Andrei Tarkovsky about a space station around a planet that allows them to imagine that they are seeing things that they feel guilty about or sentimental about from their own past lives.
Panic attack.
So that's the whole gimmick, and then you just cross fertilize it with something that attacks them or doesn't attack them. And what you do is you take a great idea, as in Solaris, and you cheapen it down, you dumb it down, and then you wind up with something like Event Horizon.
Now that we've covered some of its inspirations, let's jump into the things that were inspired by Event Horizon.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so like a diamond in the sky. When the blazing sun is on, when there nothing shines upon. Though I know not what you are, twinkle, twinkle, little star.
Space centers on Isaac Clarke, an engineer sent out to investigate the planet-cracking ship, the USG Ishimura. His girlfriend Nicole has been stationed on the ship and had sent him a distress signal. His crew find the Ishimura completely black with signs of violence all around, but no crew to start with. Then we're introduced to the Necromorphs, an obvious melding of alien xenomorphs with the creature from The Thing. This is not a game where you use conventional weapons to take them out. Instead, you must sever their limbs to finally put down these abominations. As the games go on, we're introduced to a whole space station that has been taken over by the Necromorphs. Dead Space 2 even explores the religion Unitology that had been built around the markers that sparked the Necromorphs' creation. So we go from a ship inspired by the Notre Dame Cathedral to seeing actual stained glass windows and religious iconography in Dead Space 2 as we fight off undead hordes. One of the interesting notes Paul W.S. Anderson hits in his commentary is that they cut out the actual guns featured in the script and replaced them with nail gun equivalents instead, because it didn't make sense to Paul that they'd be going around space as a rescue team with firearms, especially since they've established that there are no aliens or monsters in this universe. Which, I mean, the whole idea of the ship is that it goes to a separate chaos dimension that resembles hell, but whatever, Jan. This obviously helped inform the design ethos of Dead Space as well, where the weaponry was improvised mining tools, since the Necromorphs could only be killed by severing their limbs rather than the usual headshots. Now, I could probably do a whole video on George R.R. Martin's Nightflyers and its various adaptations. Comment below if you'd like to hear about their differences. But honestly, the only adaptation that takes its cues from Event Horizon is from the 2018 sci-fi television series.
Three men are down.
It wasn't an accident.
This mission faces a threat you do not understand.
That was no malfunction. It wanted me.
Shut it down.
I can't get control back.
Our friends are dying.
There is something wrong with this ship.
The story focuses on the temporary crew of the Nightflyer as they cross space to intercept an alien race known as the Vulcran. In the original story, the ship is not used to having a crew and is ferrying them into deep space, since no one else would take them on this fool's errand, and is helmed by a reclusive captain whose past is shrouded in mystery. While the latter part of this is still intact for the series, the Nightflyer has a full crew. The main difference in this version is that they include a psychic character, whose ability is to project visions of the crew's worst fears, leading to most of them being outright hostile toward him. His powers work on the same psionic wavelength as the Vulcran, and as a result, his powers become more powerful the closer he gets to them. For the first several episodes, this translates into Event Horizon-style visuals that try to break the crew, before things inevitably turn more dire as the danger spirals further and further out of control. I will say that, unlike Event Horizon, they do follow the well-worn path of a stowaway consciousness that is behind a lot of the issues, though not all of them. The show goes to some truly bonkers places, even if not all of them land, but there's little argument that Event Horizon isn't part of its base DNA. What if I told you that there was a pseudo-sequel to Event Horizon, taking place in the same universe but more than 100 years later? Well, I might be stretching that last fact a bit, but 2009's Pandorum fits that bill rather well.
Here, borrow me. Where's the rest of the crew?
I don't know.
Where the hell is everyone?
Our search is reacting to its final state.
I need you to show me the way.
No one ever comes back.
Not that much time.
Final phase before shutdown. Before we lose everything.
Run! Go!
Tell me! What happened?
It's Pandorum.
Now look, I understand this is technically its whole separate thing, but even more so than the connective tissue that brings together Hellraiser and Event Horizon, there are specific creative decisions that firmly plant this in the same universe. For those that haven't seen it, I'm not going to give much beyond the basic idea because this film is completely worth watching. Pandorum follows Ben Foster's Bower, who wakes up from his hypersleep in an all but inoperative deep space ship with little to no memory. He deals with the effects of being suspended for way too long, but we piece together what happened on the ship at the same time he does. However, as opposed to a ship that traveled to hell and brought something back, Pandorum instead focuses on the weird abominations in society that have popped up after generations grew up on a blacked out ship that they don't understand. Funny thing is, while the creatives behind Pandorum were mostly brand new people putting together this dark science fiction horror film, it was produced by both Jeremy Bolt and Paul W.S. Anderson. They also got the concept artist Dominic Lavery, who had worked on Event Horizon, to design Pandorum. As for further connections, both films start with a specific set of dates to help ground you in the universe. Event Horizon was set in 2047 without much of a statement on how the planet was working. However, the events of Pandorum take place initially in an unknown timeline. They do set the stage, but only the initial launch of the Elysium colony ship in 2174 is really pertinent. Throughout the story, we get an idea of the dates, like Bower is from the fifth crew change out that happens every 8 years, so we have a rough idea of how long they've been out there, though this does seem rather small once we realize the true scope of their time in isolation. We even get an empty hyperbunk with Cooper's name on it, a nod to our resident wisecracking crew member. I do find it interesting how they used the new film to deal with and answer previous issues and criticisms they'd had. Things like the original spacesuits in Event Horizon made it impossible for the actors to sit, so they had to build a rig to hold them up so they could even relax between takes.
It was one of the problems we had on the film was the actors were just weighed down by the spacesuits. They took forever to put on, you know, it took like 45 minutes to get them in the boots, the suits, the big backpacks, the helmets. Then once they were in those suits, they could only spend like 10 minutes in them because the weight was so incredible. So we ended up building these resting posts for them, and they would just lean against them and get a bit of rest.
The first obstacle Bower has to get over is getting himself off the arm that held him up during hypersleep. A lot of jokes have been made at the expense of Miller's wobbly captain's chair. So instead we get a simple console for most of the movie, and an even simpler chair once we make it to the bridge. As an elevator pitch, I'd call this Event Horizon meets The Descent. It carries forward all the lessons Paul W.S. Anderson learned on Event Horizon, creating a more cohesive story about adaptation and survival. Like my Fallen video, I once again have found a fan edit that I thoroughly enjoyed that helped focus this film. Created by Malo, Killer Horizon was released in October 2008 and cuts out roughly 16 minutes of the movie, while adding quick clips and sound effects from other sources in order to help heighten the atmosphere and terror that was undercut with a lot of superfluous dialogue. The biggest change is starting with Weir's nightmare aboard the Lewis and Clark. though it is heavily spliced with other movies such as Sunshine and Lord of Illusions, which is my favorite Clive Barker film. Overall, I'd say this is a hell of an edit that really amplifies the tension throughout. The only drawback is that the fan edit was released in 2008, and as a result, is only available in 360p. So, essentially a VHS tape. Unfortunately, Killer Horizon is no longer available at fanedit.info. I've still got a copy of it, along with the Azazel fan edit, that are available for my patrons at the $1 tier. And that's it. What are your thoughts on Event Horizon? Was this a foundational horror film for you like it was for me? Or do you think it's overhyped drivel like most of the critics thought when it was released? Once again, I wanted to thank Paul Kane for his work. The Hellraiser films and their legacy was truly a transformative work for me, completely changing the way I look at film connections and the collaborative effort of stories. Without his hard work, I never would have made the Rob Vidgeon connection, and this would have been an entirely different video. He is an absolute pleasure on Twitter. Follow him at Paul Kane Shadow and let him know I sent you. As always, you can find me on Twitter at Justin D. Heard or on my website, justindheard.com. We've also got merch up on Teespring and TeePublic. Links below. Please consider supporting us on Patreon like these fine people. I know it may seem like a long way off, but once we hit 50 patrons, I'll be able to unleash my 2-hour Hellraiser retrospective, the expanded version of my Cinebitic Rambling episode from years ago. I'm super hyped for this, and I hope you are too. It's been an absolute pleasure entertaining you, but it's getting late. I'm all sewn up. Close the door behind you. Hell is just a word. The reality is much, much worse. The dark inside of me. Some days they were getting nothing done. People fucking each other to death. We were quite inspired by the Cuban Hellraiser and the way it reshapes and realigns itself. Pain and pleasure, indivisible.